Alright, today I wanted to do a video series on how to mod the Hori Real Arcade Pro Sticks that are available for the Xbox 360 and the PS3. Now, both of these sticks will also work on the PC. Just plug in and you can play right there. There's no hassle, there's no installing any separate program. You just plug it in and play. And these are for the for what I'm going to do with this stick. It's I'm going to change out the, I'm going to put in my own artwork. I'm going to put a piece of plexi on top, and then I'm going to change out the dishwasher, the buttons, and the ball top. And I'm just going to keep the start and select buttons and the this the same. And I'm going to keep all the 8 buttons there. And for the tools, let me move on to the tools here. And you're going to need an X-Acto blade. And if your blade does dull out, they do sell the replacement blades. And you can get these at a craft store, Walmart. So these are easy to find. Something with a thin edge on top to pry open the quick disconnects that hold the buttons in. And you also want to get a flathead screwdriver to unscrew the ball top, and a Phillips head screwdriver to unscrew the bottom of the Hori Real Arcade for the PS3. What I have here are the Saimetsu buttons that I got from Lizard Lick, and these are, I believe, $3 or $4. And I'll put the link in the description box. And the good thing about these is that they're screw-in, which I found is easier to install than the snap-in buttons, especially if you put a piece of plexi on. Like when I was doing these are snap-in buttons, and when I was doing these ones, I found it kind of hard to install. With these ones, they you don't snap them; you just pretty much just screw them in. And the cool thing about these ones is you can put the art inside the button. So rather than just having a solid color like these Sanmo buttons here, you can have your artwork continue on even through the buttons. The buttons won't block out your artwork. And I believe, I'm not sure if there's any Sanmo buttons that are able to do that, but I know the Saimetsu buttons, they do have an option to put your artwork in the buttons. And I also have the mesh ball top here that is quite a bit more expensive than the regular ball top. And the it's basically got a checkered pattern on the ball, and it's I got it for $12, and for the regular ball top it's around $3 or $4, I believe. So if you're looking for something different, you can get the mesh ball, but I'd recommend just sticking with the regular solid color. It'll save you quite a bit of money there. And but the pattern you won't be able to see, but it is subtle on the white ones. But if you get like a darker color, like a black or blue, you can see the checkered pattern pop out more. And it's all got solid feel to it. It's not like there's no dimples or anything like that. It's just like a regular ball top. It's just got the patterns engraved onto the ball there. And I also got the artwork that I'm going to be using that I got from Staples. And I'll show you how to put it onto the template in either using Photoshop, or you can either use Photoshop or GIMP. Since I don't have Photoshop, I'll be showing you how to use GIMP to edit it. And then you can go to either a local print shop, or if you have a Staples nearby, you can print these out. They're about, I got it for like $1 for each printout. And what you can do is you can get 2 of each copy. That way, if you mess up cutting one, you have the other one there. You don't have to, you know, go back, drive back to the store to get another copy. Or if you have a couple in mind, what I did was I had 4 different images. I wasn't sure which one I really wanted, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna cut them out, put them on the stick, and see how it looks, and then I'll go from there. I'll choose which one. And I also got a plexi top with a custom dust washer for the stick. And I got this from techinnovations.com, and he's got a lot of different products. It's a reliable site, and the prices are really good. And it's a one-man operation, I believe, so the processing times do take a while, about a week or two, but it does come when it It does come fast. It's about 2 to 3 days shipping when it does ship, and it's packaged really well. And he's got a lot of different products that you can't find anywhere else. And for example, like the dishwasher here, it has you can put your own custom image on there, or you can have it like a mirror, so that when you're playing, it basically shows the mirrored image. And he's got, for the plexi top, he's got a solid color plexi, mirror style plexis, or just a regular see-through one. And you can either go with the plexi top, or if you're gonna go with the artwork, you want to get it laminated, which you can also get done at Staples, and I believe local print shops should offer the same service. And right here, one of the sticks that I have, it's the Hori Real Arcade Pro EXSE, which stands for the Saimetsu. It's got a Saimetsu buttons and the joystick. I'm not sure if that's the correct pronunciation. And for my Hori Real Arcade Pro, the regular one that I got for the PS3, I installed the Sanwa buttons, and it came with a Sanwa stick. And this one has the plexi. And actually, both sticks have the same body type. They're pretty much the same thing. It's just for this particular one, you can take the top metal panel out from just unscrewing it from the top. Whereas in order to take the top metal panel out, which you'd want to do to get to uninstall the buttons and the stick and that type of thing, in order to get behind the top metal part here, you'd have to actually go from the bottom, which would take longer. But on techinnovations.com, he's got accessories that allow you to modify the Hori Real Arcade Pro for the PS3 so that you can actually unscrew it from the top and then just, pull it out, much like how it is with the EXSE stick. And I think that's pretty much it. What you'd also want to do, what I do to keep the dust away from my sticks, is when the sticks ship, they come with this blue plastic bag, and I just stick them in there, keep the dust out. And also, what you need, or you actually, it's not unnecessary, but this is a self-healing mat that you can get at a craft store or Walmart. And what you want to do is you want to put your artwork on here and then use the X-Acto knife to cut it, because when you cut anything on the self-healing mat, it won't get stuck. And any cuts you make in here will, I guess you can say they'll heal up, they'll get covered up. It's a pretty cool thing to use if you're going to make anything, if you're going to cut with anything. And but the thing I noticed when I was working on this stick here is that you want to use if you're using a plexi top, you can either use that or the metal panel as a guide. But you want to be careful you use a plexi as a guide, because actually because I had the my image, and then I had the plexi on top of that using it as a guide when I was cutting. And when I was cutting, my X-Acto knife jumped up and I scraped the I got a little cut on the plexi. So what you want to do is you want to be careful with that, and you're going to need a 7mm hex driver and in order to take the to disassemble the top metal panel on the Hori Real Arcade Pro for the PS3, which would be this one right here. And now if you want to change the color of the plastic outer rim here, what you can do, what I recommend using, is vinyl dye. Because what the vinyl dye does, it actually will seep into the plastic to change the color, rather than just covering it like spray paint will. And the vinyl dye is pretty easy to use. So I'd recommend that. You can get them at like your auto parts store. They also sell them online as well. And you can do that if you want to change the color. Or if, let's say for example, you have a 360 and a PS3 and you don't want to get two sticks, what you can do is you can dual mod your arcade stick so that, for example, the Hori Real Arcade Pro 3 will work with both the 360 and the PS3. And it is tricky doing that, and it does require some technical know-how. There are guides out there that'll help you walk you through it. But again, it is it's not the easiest thing to do, the easiest mod that that you can do in relation to an arcade stick. But for this one, I'm just going to just swap out the buttons and the artwork, which is pretty easy to do compared to, for example, dual modding. And so right now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to show you how to disassemble the Hori Real Arcade Pro for the PS3, and then after I do that, I'm going to show you how to mod the Hori EXSC. But it's going to pretty much work the same way, you know, for example, changing out the artwork, changing out the buttons, and the ball top will work pretty much the same as how you would do it on the other Hori stick here. Okay, for the Hori Real Arcade Pro 3, what you want to do is, with the Phillips head screwdriver, you just want to, you'll need a small one, you just want to unscrew all of the screws that you see visible. There's nothing under the pads here, so you don't have to peel them out, they're just pads. You just want to unscrew the visible screw heads right here. And then after I unscrew this, I'll show you what's underneath here. And once you unscrew them, you just want to use the same screwdriver and just try to pop it out. And just stick it in and then pop it towards you. And that's going to, actually I got this a little propped out already. Okay, and here's the inside. And inside here is the guts of the stick, but in order to get in there, you actually have to go from the top. In order to unscrew the top, you have to unscrew the bolts here in the middle, and there. It's basically on each four corners, and then in the middle here, and then here, and there. And it's what you'll need is the 7mm hex driver to unscrew these. And the way you want to do it, well, how I do it is I keep it on my lap so that the two bolts here are on my one leg, force pressed against my one leg, and the two screws here are pressed against my other leg, so that while I'm unscrewing them, the top the screw is pressed against my leg, so it makes it easier to unscrew. What you gotta be careful is when you're unscrewing them, you have to make sure that you hold the top plate, and basically as you're using your hand as a vise, you want to squeeze them so that when you move this towards you to get those screws out, this top panel doesn't fall out to the floor since there's no screws holding it in. So it has a tendency to want to, you know, pop out due to, you know, gravity and due to the weight, because that's just a metal panel there. So just make sure that if you're moving it away from your lap, that you hold it, have a strong grip on that, and so it doesn't pop out. So now that they're all unhooked, you just want to again give it a strong grip, turn it around, and now you can lift the, actually you want to, and there you have all of the parts. And these are the disconnects that you just take out using a just, you know, screwdriver, flathead screwdriver to take those out. And there's the you'll see here, you use a flathead screwdriver, stick it in the slot here, hold it, and while you're holding it steady, you can unscrew the ball top, and then you can take you can lift this out from the stick, or if it's loose, you can tighten it by basically turning it the opposite way while holding that, because as you turn it, you'll see that this moves, so that's why you gotta hold it with the screwdriver. And that's pretty much it. And the again, if you're looking for and easier way to take this apart, you want to look for the top loaders on techinnovations.com. And basically what he does is he glue in these segments underneath here, and then you basically screw in regular screws in here, and that holds the top panel. So all you do is unscrew these, and then you can take the top panel out, so it's much easier. So I recommend checking his website. He's also got a demonstration video on how they operate, so definitely check that if you want an easier way to get into the guts of the HRAP 3 for the PS3. When you're putting back the screws for here, actually let me turn this around. Okay, and again, when you flip it over, you just want to make sure you grip it tight so that the top panel doesn't fall out when you're moving it, because again, it's not screwed in. So when you flip it back around to, you know, reinstall the screws, here's the screws that were in the top portion. Again, this is all, there's no indentation, so that's why you had to unscrew it from behind. So what you want to do is just lift it a little bit, just enough to get the screw in. There we go. And then just press it against your knee so it stays firm. And then for this little tiny washer, you just want to stick it in to the hex driver and make sure it's even in there, and then you can basically push it in there. For these big holes, it's not, you don't really have to do that, because you can easily just use your fingers and put it on top. But when you, for these ones, since they're so, you can't really stick your fingers in there, so what you do is you just want to put it in there. Oops. And just make sure it's laying, you know, flat like that. And then you just want to lift this towards you, so that as you insert the, because if you go like this, it's just going to fall out. So you just want to, and that's pretty much it. And then you can do the same thing with the bigger nut. Just stick it in the top here. And just make sure it's set correctly, and then you can just stick it in. If you have a one that has like a magnetic end, it'd be much easier, because then you can easily, you know, just go like that and it won't fall. So that's pretty much it. And then after you screw in all the screws, just put the metal plate back on, screw it back on, and you're all finished. I forgot to mention that when you're screwing them back in, you want to do it, screw this one in, and then just go across from it, screw that one in. That way the board doesn't warp. So basically you don't have to start with this one, but as you're screwing them in, you want to go from the opposite direction. You also don't want to tighten these too tight, because it'll warp the plexi. You just want to tighten them, you know, just so that they're snug. You don't want to, you don't really crank on that. You don't want to do that. So just keep those two tips in mind when you're screwing those back in. And another thing you want to be aware of before you actually close this up is you want to make sure that the screws here are flush with either the plexi or the metal panel, because it's like when you screw in a bottle cap, like a milk carton, you screw the cap back on, and sometimes it'll get stuck and you're screwing it in crooked. That's pretty much how these work. You want to make sure that when you screw them back in, they're even, they're not, you know, lying crooked, they're lying, you know, flat like that. And you also, again, you want to make sure you don't screw them in super tight, because you're, it's gonna, for the plexi, you'll warp it. So you want to make sure you keep that in mind as well. And actually, once again, I failed to mention that before, you put the, after you screw in everything and make sure they're sitting flush, you want to make sure that the wire is correctly placed. For like example, this screw right here, You want to make sure the wire is next to it, not on top of it, and that this is in its correct position, right, like that. Because when you put the top panel, you don't want this wire getting crushed. So once it's right next to it, everything's in sitting, you know, next to the poles, not on top. You're all set to put the middle panel back on. So if I were to slide my hand across, it would go smoothly. That's not how it wants. You want to have it installed. You want to kind of, you know, move it around until it sits in. It kind of, you know, sits in further than the ledge here, so that when I move my hand, you'll hear that. That means it's installed correctly. You'll feel this edge here, and so that means it's sitting in there rather than sitting equally on top of the ledge. So once that's done, you want to make sure again you screw in the screws in a cross formation. That way you don't put stress on the board here. And for these, you don't want to make them, you know, you don't want to crank them. You just want to make sure that they're hand tight. They're just snug. As soon as you feel that resistance, put a little tiny bit, and then that's it. And then afterwards, after you put all the screws in, you just want to flip it around, grab just like a little microfiber cloth, and you can get them at, like, for example, at any eyeglass shop. For example, like I know the Super Walmart, they have their own little section where they sell eyeglasses, do you know, the examinations and all that. In that section, usually it's in near the front cash registers. They'll have them laying on the wall, and they're usually like in a little plastic bag, and they're like a couple bucks, two, three, $4, and they're, you know, small, square shape, and I like to get two of them so that when I'm cleaning my my top panel where the plexi's at, since it gets, you know, grimy with the dead skin and the fingerprints, you want to just wet one of them, you know, just, you know, make sure you get all the smudges and the dead skin and all that. And then with the other microfiber cloth that's dry, you just want to dry it up. So I would recommend getting two of them, and then because they're washable, you can hand wash them, put them out to dry, and then keep reusing them. So, and also the microfiber cloths are good because they won't scratch the plexi, and which is you want to you know, you want to avoid, because you want to make it, you know, you want to keep it looking nice. Okay, and so when you're wiping it down, you just want to make sure you use the you never wipe it using the tattered edges here, because there's a slight chance that it may scratch the plexi. You don't want to, you know, really force scrub it. You just want to gently, slowly scrub it. And that way you won't get any of the super light scratches that you would with like a paper towel. So what you'd want to do is you just want to bend it a little, or maybe put your finger here so that you got just the nice edges here, and then just wipe it down, wipe the buttons and everything, and then you just want to dry it with either the dry end here. You, for example, just wet the top half. You can dry this, use this dry end to dry it, or another microfiber cloth to dry it on up. And you don't want to put too much water on your cloth, because you don't want the water seeping inside to the electrical components. So just enough to, you know, just so it's damp, and just, you know, scrub. You know, if you need a little bit more, you can always add much. But you always want too little rather than too much, because again, you don't want the water getting into these inside here. And for your plexi top, you just want to make sure that you clean both sides of it. And it's really simple. You just under the sink, just, you know, some water, dish soap, you know, you can use your hands for that. You don't have to use the microfiber cloths. You know, rinse it, all the soap out. And then you would use the microfiber cloths to dry them on up. And when you're drying it, in order to avoid getting more fingerprints on it, just grab it with the hose, and that way the only fingerprints that you'll be getting is on the edges here. But again, that doesn't matter. But if you do get some you know, random fingerprints on it, with the dry microfiber cloth, you'll get rid of them pretty easily. But again, you just want to make sure that when you first get it, you just want to give it a quick clean to get rid of the stuff that the packaging leaves on. And I forgot to mention that when unscrewing the screws from the EXSE stick, that you want to use an Allen wrench. And it's going to be about a medium size wrench, but when you get these in the store, they usually come in packs of various sizes, so you should it should include the right size. You just have to be careful that you don't lose the gold washer, since they are pretty tiny. And so what I do is I'll just have them all there. And there's another gold washer in the hole here. So again, you gotta be careful that one doesn't come out when you take the sticker out to replace it with your own art image. And so once this is out, all you have to do is lean the stick towards you, lift it up and towards you, and this will pop out. And when you lift it up and out, you just want to again make sure that the gold washer is in the corner here. Don't fall out. And here's the guts of the stick. And basically, what you want to do is get the quick disconnects out first, both of the cables, and then just squeeze the two buttons on the side, and then you should be able to pop it out. An easy way to take out the disconnects here is you want to pull up until it pops up a little bit, and then when you stick the flathead screwdriver in the opening between the end of the quick disconnect and the black box here, you want to basically stick it in so that the flathead is even with the connector. So you want to stick the flathead so that the connector is in the middle, and then you want to basically you want to twist the screwdriver left all the way, and then twist it all the way to the right as much as you can. You don't want to use a lot of force, just I would say about a medium amount, and then just keep doing that slowly. Turn it all the way as far as you can, all the while pulling up with your other hand, and then eventually it'll pop up. It's much easier than going in like little short movements. You want to go slow and long movements, and then do it again. Now when you put them in, they're easy. It's just taking them out, it's kind of a hassle. And for the joystick, you can just to take it out, you can easily pull the sticker out leaving the joystick in, but for example, let's say you want to change out the joystick, or it's broken, or you just want to make it easier pulling the sticker, you just want to unscrew it from the mounting plate right here. So you just want to unscrew it. Unfortunately, the way they shipped it to me, one of the screw heads were stripped, so I'll have to, if I ever want to change this out, I'll have to get around that, unfortunately. And these things are in there super tight, so yeah. But yeah, that's and you also want to make sure you take out the tape here, because you don't want to, when you take them out, you want to be careful with the little wires here that are glued to the connectors. You want to look at the color of the wire and see what button's connected to, and then you want to jot that down on a piece of paper, so that when you reconnect all these wires, you know which button goes to which. So I'm just pushing in the little tabs here. There's a tab on one side and the tab right on the opposite side, and I'm just pushing them in until, not with too much force, you can, but this little part will break off, the little tab will break. I'm just pushing it in enough so that the button will pop through. Sometimes the button will come out halfway, but on the other end, you'll see a gap here. And basically, you can use a flathead screwdriver, shove it in there, and try to jimmy it off. And just make sure, keep looking back and making sure the tab didn't pop back out. And just keep pushing the tab in with the screwdriver and then keep wedging the flathead in and try to pop it on out. And this is why I like going with the screw-ins, because it's easier to take in and out with the snap-ins. It's for me, I've always found them harder to take out. Okay, and since I couldn't get the screwdriver, not the screwdriver, the joystick out, I'm just gonna leave it there. And what I'm gonna do is I'm going to start from the corner here. Basically, this is just one giant sticker, and you just wanna peel this up and out. And you wanna be careful because there's a gold washer there, so you just want to carefully try to take it out without losing it. And then you just want to set it aside, and then you just want to continue peeling it. It's kind of stuck on there, so it's kind of tough to peel this on out, but just keep at it. And I did this before on my the Hori arcade pro 3, and it was able to, when I was peeling it, this was able to basically go over the little joystick here. So hopefully that's the case again, but I'm gonna continue peeling this out, and we'll see if that does work, or if I had to take this out. Okay, and so I finally got it out. It was kind of a little tricky to get it over the joystick, but what you can do is you can cut this if you have large pair of scissors, or the garden snips. You can just cut on the side here, just a slit, and that should allow you to peel it over the joystick handle there. And and as you go along, just make sure to take the little gold washers out, and that's pretty much it. And you're left with a incredibly wrinkled giant sticker, which is still a little bit sticky, so I'll toss that out. And what you see here is that they sanded down the screws, and so that the sticker would lay flat. And in our case, what we're going to do now is we're going to put the artwork on here, and it'll allow it to lay flat as well as a plexi. And so now that we got the this out, we can start working on cutting our art piece. And what you also want to do is you just want to go around and make sure that there's no sticky gunk. There really shouldn't be. I did this with my PS3 version, and it also peeled out nice and didn't leave any gunk behind, which is a good thing. Less work. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to set this aside, and I'm going to get my healing mat set up. And I'm gonna start working on cutting my art pieces. Okay, what I'm doing now is basically I just put my plexi on top of the image that I'm going to place on the stick, and I'm just basically with the X-Acto knife, I'm just cutting it along the edges here. I'm not gonna cut through the buttonholes. I'm just going to cut along all of the edge. And once I'm going to get that out, I'm going to put it on the stick and see how I like it. And then if whichever one I pick, I'll then proceed to cut out the buttonholes. And the turbo section and the start and select buttons, I'm going to cut out completely. But the main and also the joystick button right under my hand here. But the 8 buttons here, I'm going to cut and keep, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to put that artwork inside of the main buttons. You can do that with the start and select buttons as well, but in my case, I didn't buy those smaller buttons, So I'm just gonna leave the original black buttons there, and the turbo button, turbo sections is gonna be with the headphone port and the Xbox button. So I'm gonna continue cutting through all four of my images, and then I'm gonna try them on the arcade stick. And again, you just want to make sure that you go slowly with the that you basically you hold down the plexi on top of the image, you hold it down firm, and then you just cut along the edge of the edge of the image here. And as you're cutting, you don't want to cut like this at a high angle. What you want to do instead is try to cut at an even angle, which will reduce the chances of your blade kicking up and scratching the plexiglass here. In order to cut the circles and the square accurately, or actually I should say easier, what you want to do is a cross pattern. So what you'd want to do is with the X-Acto knife, cut that way, and then cut that way, and then start going around the circle. And using all you have to do to take the little piece, each four pieces out, is to stab it with the X-Acto knife and just flick it out. And some of the corners might be won't allow it to get won't allow you to pop it out, but you know, just you can either just yank it out, or just use the X-Acto knife to cut that little bit out and be able to take it apart. And the same goes with the box. Just cut it one way, cut it that way diagonally, and then cut it normally, and it'll be easier to handle. And that's pretty much it. And so once you get the all those buttons, actually, for the, if you're going to put the art, these four buttons and these four buttons, what you want to do is, you don't want to use the diagonal method because you'll ruin the art. You actually want to go around the image. But remember, just go slow and keep the knife low as possible. Don't keep it at a high angle because it can kick up. But with this one, you kind of had to angle it up a bit more to be able to go around the circle. So just go, make sure you just go slow and keep a steady hand. And in order to get this top button out, what you want to do is, you'll see a notch there and a notch there, basically on opposite sides. You just want to push that in with a, you can use a Phillips head screwdriver and just gently push it in, push this one in. And then what you want to do is, for example, you want to push it in and then down, or I guess towards the top of the button, and then go on the other side, do the same thing, push it in and out, and basically you're going to wiggle it, so this side will come out, then that side will come out, and just keep doing that until the button, you can pull the button out. Okay, once the top button is out, and you'll see the button that when you press in the button triggers and goes through the contacts. And here is the top portion, and all you gotta do is take this inner part out, and there you go. And then here is the clear top. And so what you're gonna do with this is, you're gonna basically take your image, put it face down, put this the white button in the middle, and then you're going to trace it with a pencil, and then just cut it out with a pair of scissors, and then that way it'll be able to fit inside this top white portion. And then it may be a little snug, so you may have to cut a little tiny bit more, but then you what you want to do before you once this is cut to the proper size, you want to actually put a piece of, you can get a double-sided tape, or you can just get regular tape and just loop it around. stick it on this end, stick it on the button right here, and then just put the stop in so that way this won't go sliding around. And so once you got that connected, you just put it back into here, and as you push it in, you want to push it on all the way down until the little snap-in triggers. Actually, I can show you on one of these ones. So that when you press the button in, the this part goes all the way down, and so that it'll be correctly working. Because if you don't, it won't get depressed all the way. So when you pop this top cap in, you got to push it in, and it should work fine. And then that's pretty much it. And then you have the screw-ins. And for these, the way it's installed is, in the bottom you'll see two rings. It's kind of hard to see, but you'll see like two silver rings. And then in the top portion here is kind of blank. This top portion part would spin up and press against the metal panel. And the two silver rings would actually be on the bottom, near the bottom of the button. And that's how you would screw it in. Okay, and so you'll notice there's a little notch in here that matches up with the plunger here. And so what you want to do is when you insert it, you'll see these hooks that you want to match up with the space right here. And so as you're pushing it in, look through the hole right here on the side and look up and try to match the slot here with the slot here. It matches up naturally, but you just want to, as you're pushing it in, look through the hole, and it'll be easier so when you snap it in, it sits in perfectly right from the start. So that's a tip you want to use when you're putting these things back together, is just look through the hole and look up and try to match this the plunger here with the little slot in here, and it'll fit in nicely. Okay, so what you want to do is, before you put the plexi on, is you want to make sure you give it another cleaning, and you also want to clean the dust washer if you have a clear one. And what you do now is just you want to take the buttons and make sure that they match with the correct placement. And it's for the screw-ins, it's pretty easy. They just pretty much go right in with no problem. And then what you want to do to make it easier is just put in one and then flip it around and then screw it in. When you do flip it, probably the easiest way is to flip this all around and then just insert these screws backwards. So it would be, you'd have to make sure, actually what you'd want to probably do is see which ones go where and then place them in order. So for example, it'll be four on top, four on bottom. Oh, I don't got no room. There we go. Let's set them right there. So this will be pretty much the same layout as on here, so that once you figure out where which button goes where, then you flip it over and you'll know which button goes to where, so you don't have to keep flipping this back up and down, and then you just insert it backwards, hold it with one hand, and the other hand you screw it tight, or actually you don't want to screw it tight, you just want to screw it so that it holds. And then what you want to do is you just want to make sure that you align it correctly so that it matches with the picture, and then you can tighten it. And then once you get all the buttons in, you just want to screw back the screws in and make sure that you have both of the gold washers, and then just pretty much just screw it right in. And that's it, you're all set. And what you want to do is plug it into your Xbox or your PC and test it, make sure that everything works. And actually, no, I'm sorry, when you do install the buttons, you do have to install the quick disconnects before you screw everything in. So you install the buttons and then you plug in the quick disconnects with the list that you made. Here's my list that I made here. I'm not sure if this is standard for all of the sticks, but these are the buttons, and then the colors, the wires that go to the buttons. So what you want to do is once you install each of the buttons, you just put the quick disconnects. You just pop them right back in. They go in pretty easily, and then you can screw everything in and then test it to make sure that the stick is working and that the buttons are working and everything is good. That the headphone port and the Xbox button. Unfortunately, I noticed that the placement of the joystick is way too close to the buttons, so this button's not going through. So what I just did was I just screwed it in on the top there. I might be able to sand down the screw here, and it might be able to fit under here, under the mounting mechanism here. I don't think that would work, because it looks, actually it might. What I had to do is I had to find a way to, if you have like a Dremel with the sanding bit, that'll probably work, and then you can get it, to fit in there, because the way it is now, I tried to fit it in there, but it wasn't going through, so I just did this, as a way to, you know, get the button stuck in there. But that's unfortunately one of the drawbacks to having this joystick. The placement is way too close, and then also it's as you can see here, it was a tight fit with the screws. Okay, so what I did was I filed the one, like two segments here. I just filed it off so that it resembled like a little bowl shape, and that enabled me to fit the end in. I had to install it reverse style compared to how these were. The way the ring is, it has like the two strips on the bottom, and then the top part of the ring here is blank. I basically flipped that around and installed it that way, but this way it's more secure than how I had it with the ring lying on top of the mounting unit right here. So I managed to get it to fit in. So for those that are following this guide and want to install the screw-in buttons, all you need is a file, or if you have a Dremel with a sanding bit, you can use that and just sand away or file away just a little tiny bit, enough so that you can fit, as you can see right there, enough so that you can fit this a length from here to here. And actually, here we go. So what you want to do is from here to there, you want to sand that bit down, and that would enable you to shove it in, and you can still screw it in. When you screw it in, the main button here is going to come in contact with the edge of this metal plate, but just keep pushing it in, keep screwing it in, and it'll still go through. Okay, I finally got this this stupid button installed. It took like half an hour to do it, because again, it's so close to the joystick. The problem was, as I was screwing it in, I actually had to screw it in with both hands screwed in. And also, when you're screwing these buttons in, you want to hold them by the side. You never want to push down on the plunger, you know, use unnecessary force. Just hold down on the sides while you screw in the back nut, plastic nut. But in this case, I had to turn this, use this as to tighten it, and then when the back piece was stuck out enough, I turned the back piece. And When I tightened it down, unfortunately this chain piece was over here. It wasn't, the design wasn't matching up. So what I had to do was I had to take the whole button out and dismantle it, and basically take this top portion out like how I did to put the art image in, and flip it around, and then pop it back in, and then screw it all in, and it finally got it to match. So if you're doing the same mod, you might have to do that. You might have to play around with this. You might have to take out your image again and adjust it in a way that when you screw it down fully, it matches with your background image. So unfortunately, due to the way they had this panel laid out, it's a pain in the butt to get this button taken care of. This is actually the final design. I had this propped open because I had to put the disconnects in, and I got the clear dishwasher. I keep calling it the dishwasher. It's the dust washer. And then here's the design, and it's a pretty neat thing that you can put the art under the buttons, and you can see it kind of has like a little 3D effect where it pops out the image
I have hooked to my PC. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to test it to make sure that all the buttons work, that that nothing's wrong with it. So once you hooked in your controller, you just want to go to the control panel and then click on game controllers, and then this box will pop up, and it'll show arcade stick in parentheses real arcade pro .x and status okay. So you want to go to properties, and then this box pops up, and what you want to do is every time you press a button, it'll light up. It's hard to tell on the video here, but it's one of the buttons that I'm pressing is lighting up, so I'm just going to go through all of them just to make sure that they're all going in. And they're all working good. So that's all set. And Once you do that, you're pretty much set. You can start playing. Okay, and so when you open up the GIMP program, it's going to display like this. You'll have the main box here, and then two sidebars, a toolbox, and then you'll have this box right here that has all the layers and all the patterns and whatnot. And so basically what it's an image manipulation program, and like Photoshop. And so what you want to do is basically go to File, and then Open, and then you want to go to where you have your template saved, the one that you got from the Shoruken forums. And then when you open that up, it's going to load in. And then this is how it's gonna look. And so this is the template here, and if you go to the layer box, you're gonna see these options right here. And basically the ones you want to click out, you'll see like an eyeball. Just go on the eyeball and click on it, and it'll erase what it is. So the red panel copy you wanna erase, and then you want to erase the red lines copy, and then just keep going straight up. And to see an example, for example this one, the red panel copy, when I click on it, it'll get rid of it. So all these different things, like the white buttons here and the red outline here, they're all layers. And what you're doing is you're basically clearing those out, and what you want to do is just be left with the gray background. And so you continue erasing all of these, and then I'll show you which ones that are the only ones that you want to have. So the ones that you want while you're working with your image, the ones that you want to be clicked on is the outline panel edge, the outline joystick,
outline, select and start, outline a button, and you can pick the joystick dust cover on, and basically that's going to give you the what the dust cover, what it'll look like with the dust cover on. Now if you have a clear dust cover or dust washer, it's not going to matter, but if you have one that's colored in or that's going to block the image, you'll want to have this layer on so that you know what you're working with when you're moving your image around. And so you you'll want that, and you'll also want the outline turbo and the black border. So now that you have this image right here, and you got rid of all that ViewLix layers, and you just have the basic template here, you want to go to File, and then Open as Layers. You'll want to make sure you click on that one. And then what you want to do is go to where you have your picture saved. Now this one is quite small, so what we'll have to do is we'll scale it. Now if you in order to fill this in, you'll need a super high resolution picture, and actually the higher the resolution, the more clear the picture will be. But for this picture, what we're going to do is we're going to scale it. So we go to layer and then scale layer, and then right here we're going to change that from 1280 to 2750, and then click on the height box and it changes it automatically, and then we click on scale and then it's going to load that up and then it's going to scale it. So now what we want to do is we want to move the image around so that for example the buttons are not blocking anything we don't want to block. So we go to Tools, Transform Tools, and then to move. There we go. So now we can move the image around to wherever we want. And again, you want to make sure that the turbo box here and the start and select buttons and all the buttons in the joystick are not blocking any other part of the image that you want. And you'll also have to make note that the buttons, you'll also have to factor in the outer rim of the buttons. The outer rims will cover a part of the picture, so you'll have to so you'll see the circle here. Just imagine the circle was a tiny bit bigger to compensate for the buttons rims blocking the image. And if you're going to get any etching done, for example the button icons, like X, Y, A, B, or the PlayStation symbols, you want to also note that to where it'll be showing on the picture. And and that's pretty much it. So when once you moved it to where you want it, you want to you don't want to print it like this, because when it what I found that the plexi, it doesn't match up exactly to the layout here. So if you print it out like this, the plexi is not going to match up, and you're going to still have a little bit of these black lines when you try to cut it, and it just won't look right. It's not, because the plexi, when you put it over this, once this is all printed out, the like the button layers here, they will match up with the holes on the plexi itself, and it's going to look crooked. So what you want to do is you want to go back to your layer box here, and you want to keep this up. This is the file name, and this is a file. You want to keep that clicked on. So you go all the way up, and you want to click the following off. And this is how it's going to look. So when you take it to the printers, it's going to whatchamacallit, it's gonna look like this, with the black and white checkerboard behind it, and with the picture quite bigger than what we're normally used to. Because if you go back to here and click on panel edge, you'll see the black line here. You'll see that that signifies what it's gonna look like on your metal panel and also on your plexi. But again, due to the plexi not being exactly the same size as this, from my experiences, you don't want to keep that black line there, because it's not gonna, when you try to cut it, you're gonna see some of those lines still on your picture. So what you want to do is you want to remember where you have the holes laid out. And what I would do is, before we clicked off all these layers, when we had the little button layer still on, the turbo box still marked in here, when you got all that marked and when you got your image where you want it, take a picture of that, or you can even save that image, and then so you want to use that as a reference file when you print it out. So when you print out, you want to make sure you get rid of that panel edge. And so it's a nice clean picture. So when you put your plexi on there to trace it, to cut it out, you won't have any of the black lines ruining your picture. So once that's done, you just save it, go to file, and then save, and then it'll prompt you where you want to save it and the file name. And it's gonna be the file name is gonna be .psd. So you put that on a USB drive, thumb drive, and take it to Staples or any of the local print shops, and then ask them that you want to print that out in a landscape tabloid size piece of paper, 11 by 17. And again, just ask for one copy, and then bring your plexi or your metal panel to match it up to make sure it is the right size. And that's pretty much it. Check the that Shoruken forum link that I had in the first video of this modding the arcade stick series, and I have a link there that gives you that takes you to the Shoruken web to the forum page, where it has the link to the template and also tips on what to ask for when you go to print it out. And so that's pretty much it on how to work with the GIMP and the Hori template. And this is just what I've experienced, what helped me when printing these out. And so that's pretty much it. And again, if you have any questions, please feel free to post them down in the comment section, and I'll be happy to help you out.